thank you all so much for coming. Tomorrow in the workshop with Ruth and Laura, I will be talking about disability and abortion in the EU and looking back into the 60s and 70s when abortion rights were first fought for. So that'll be a completely different topic and probably more interesting for lawyers than this intellectual history topic today, which is coming out of a different project. This one is coming out of a book I'm working on. It's called Cold War Freud, Psychoanalysis and Age of Catastrophes. And what I'm interested in are the uses of psychoanalysis to make sense of human nature in the aftermath of World War II. So the lingering after effects of fascism and the Holocaust, but also the Vietnam War, decolonization, and the sexual revolution. And the story I'm going to tell you today is a very German story. And I'm kind of curious, how many of you, before you walked in here, already knew who Conrad Lorenz is? You? Okay. How many of you about Alexander Mitscherlich? Yeah. Not quite as many. So Alexander Mitscherlich was the most famous and influential psychoanalyst in post-Nazi West Germany. Conrad Lorenz was an ethologist who studied animals, and the story is about the two of them. So let me start. In 1967, the physician and psychoanalyst Alexander Mitscherlich, with his wife Margarete, also an analyst, published what is still the most influential and internationally known product of West German psychoanalysis. In German, it's Empfehlung, and in English, it's The Inability to Mourn. The Mitscherlichs argued that what Germans had proven themselves unable to mourn was not the multiple millions of murdered Jews of Europe that had been killed in their name and in all too many cases with their assistance, but rather their own erstwhile passionate love for Adolf Hitler. Yet while this has not generally been noted, another persistent theme in the book was the question of how best to understand the phenomenon of human aggression. This included the need to develop a more complex theoretical framework than Sigmund Freud had produced. Aggression, this second great vital force besides libido, had been seen by Freud variously, at least since the topic forced itself upon him with the events of World War I, as possibly an equally powerful and parallel drive to libido, or one at odds with libido and providing a countervailing pressure, or one which got particularly mixed up with or fused with libido, or one which grew in proportion as libidinal aims were thwarted. He kept changing his mind because it's complicated. Subsequent to Freud's death in 1939, the topic went in and out of focus in the internecine debates, roiling the global psychoanalytic diaspora that was set in motion by Nazism's brutal ascent. When the topic showed up at all, it was mainly in the interstices of discussions of early childhood. We can have a whole conversation about why psychoanalysis turns to childhood at that moment. It's an overdetermined thing, but especially in the controversial emphases of, at that point, Britain-based Melanie Klein's work on greed, rage, and envy in babies. And it also appeared, albeit in a really stringently depoliticized form, in American ego psychologists Heinz Friedman and Ernst Chris's efforts to systematize Freudian ideas about individuals' normative stages of development as children. But the topic resurfaced with peculiar force in post-World War II West Germany. In no other national context would the attempt to make sense of aggression become such a core preoccupation, specifically for psychoanalysts and allied professionals. And conversely, in no other post-war national context would the wider public reception of psychoanalysis as a whole, the whole Freudian enterprise and its dual nature as a clinical and culturally critical project, be so strongly shaped by debates not over sex or anxiety or narcissism, which are the themes that preoccupy the American public, but rather over the vagaries and vicissitudes of human aggression. Although the topic of sex, inevitably with me, it's like I can't help myself. I tried to do a paper that wasn't about that, but it just happened. Yeah, ultimately, we entered the West German debate about aggression as well. The main emphasis of the controversies remained on the subject of aggression itself. This, in turn, had everything to do with the unanticipated but absolutely tremendous excitement with which the work of a non-psychoanalyst, the Austrian-German ethologist is an animal studier, yeah, Conrad Lorenz, was received in the West German media. So we can look at Conrad Lorenz with the geese following him, one of the iconic images from 1960. Lorenz was a specialist, particularly on parental imprinting on gray-like geese. they all thought he was their mommy. But also he was a devoted observer reporter of the vast repertoire of behaviors of other animals, from monkeys to rats to fish and dogs. From quite early on in the post-war years, Lawrence was a household name in West Germany due to his beguilingly folksy tales of animal doings. They're cute, okay? Published as King Solomon's Ring and Man Meets Dog. And he was well known among research professionals, including among psychoanalysts on both sides of the Atlantic, for numerous scholarly essays on instincts, evolution, and behavior. British and American analysts were especially fascinated by what they saw as the implications of his research for demonstrating the importance of early mother-child bonding. This is the 50s and early 60s after all. But often enough, status anxious and pleased to find support for their own claims about human nature, psychoanalysts followed many other aspects of Lawrence's work, and he was footnoted in an extraordinary number of post-war psychoanalytic texts. And that's a really good book that is about the psychoanalyst's reception of his mother-child stuff. Yet it was the book appearing in 1963, Das sogenannte Böse zur Naturgeschichte der Aggression. It's important that the German title is The So-Called Evil, and then it's subtitled On the Natural History of Aggression, and it was published in the United States in 66, simply as On Aggression. That was the truly blockbuster hit, which secured Lawrence's international reputation. His point was that to study animals is to understand humans. Both in the Anglo-American and in the West German context, Lawrence's book on aggression would often be read in conjunction with two further books exploring the animal origins of human behavior. They were published just a few years later. The American playwright and student of behavioral science, Robert Ardrey's The Territorial Imperative, again you see the comparison between humans and animals, and the British zoologist Desmond Morris's The Naked Ape. One strand of public fascination with these texts clearly had to do with the wave of interest in biological as opposed to sociological explanations of human nature. And not least, with a desire to re-secure traditional notions of gender in an era of rapidly changing social roles for men and women. However, there was something distinctively post-Nazi German about the glowing appreciation with which Lawrence's specific contribution to the wider context of analogizing from animals to humans was embraced. Das sogenannte Böse, the so-called evil, after all, as the German title indicated, was a vigorous defense of aggression as by no means always a force for evil. The short take-home message, amidst all these witty, cheerfully chatty accounts of animal doings, was welcome indeed for Germans. It had two main components. One, aggression is ubiquitous in animals and in people. In other words, it's not just a German specialty. Everybody is aggressive. And number two, aggression is a force for good. All cultural progress, in his view, all effective activity, the treasured bonds of deep friendships and of marital love, all these good things have their roots in the aggressive instinct. It was also, and this is ironic, Lawrence who did more than anyone else to introduce Sigmund Freud into German's national conversation on aggression. Lawrence had situated himself at the very opening of On Aggression as someone who had long been resistant to psychoanalysis, not least because he could not agree with, quote, the concept of a death drive, which according to a theory of Freud's is a destructive principle which exists as an opposite pole to all instincts of self-preservation. But then, as Lawrence reported in the book, he'd been delighted to find in his travels across the US that many American psychoanalysts did not agree with the idea of its existence either. So he goes to the Menninger Clinic in Topeka, Kansas, he hangs out in New York, he goes all over, and he's thrilled that they agree with him. But what Lawrence did find useful was Freud's belatedly found conviction that aggression, like libido, was the drive. The difference was that Lawrence was eager to see the aggressive drive as life-preserving and life-enhancing. However, unintentionally, with the publication of On Aggression set in motion was an outpouring of debate in 1967's West Germany over whether or not aggression was indeed best understood as a drive. And there's a little kerfuffle about the fact that is it best understood as a drive or an instinct? Because in fact, the early British translators of Freud into English had chosen to use the word instinct rather than drive. And Germans were very aware of this and endlessly pointed this out. But generally, Germans talked about drive, and Lawrence himself did too. So this all triggered a major conversation across the nation about whether Freud was good or bad. No other text caused more people to start wondering what Freud himself had actually argued. Not just Lawrence and his supporters, but also Lawrence's critics, and they were increasingly vociferous, contributed to the reformulation of what Freud was thought to stand for. By the later 60s and early 70s, so a few years into the popular reception of this, at least three new versions of Freud were circulating in the West German media and the wider public discussion. One was a sex radical version, the Make Love Not War crap, which restored to public attention Freud's own erstwhile commitment to seeing libido as the force that explained almost everything in life. Another, the second one, was a far more conservative Freud, who had insisted that humans were not by nature good. This version, however paradoxically, was a co-production of the supporters of Lawrence on the one hand, and those of his critics, who could not accept the idea of aggression as a drive at all, and instead proposed alternate models of human behavior which strongly emphasized the sociological or learning factors. And then the third was the complex effort at compromise that Alexander Mitchell had formulated. Henceforth, the public and professional arguments about Freud in West Germany would no longer be about whether or not to take psychoanalysis seriously. Rather, the question became which Freud would be promoted in order to advance a variety of political agendas. At the same time, all the previously assumed alignments between theoretical framework and political implications get scrambled. It's important for me to say that it's not obvious that all the leftists are sociological and all the conservatives biological. You could be straddling the two and have progressive politics or have conservative politics. It was not easy to align those things. And there's a complex subplot here. Yes, that's where I'm running door now. about the prehistory, which is that the Frankfurt School sociologist philosophers, Theodor Adorno and Max Horkheimer, had been working for quite some time to try to bring psychoanalysis back to post-Nazi and still residually anti-Semitic West German culture. Alexander Mitscherlich, one could say, was their necessary Gentile frontman. As late as 1965, that project of trying to return psychoanalysis as an important frame of reference in post-Nazi Germany was not going as well as hoped. Part two, there's five little parts, little sentences. Alexander Mitscherlich succeeded in his life project of returning psychoanalysis to post-Nazi Central Europe and securing Freud far greater prestige than it ever had in Freud's own day, primarily by advancing a highly idiosyncratic version of psychoanalysis as a secular, moral, political language. Mitscherlich became, on the one hand, the main West German representative of the psychoanalytic enterprise. One, through his, this is just Horkheimer in 65 saying it's not going well. Okay. This is Stuke, the Nature Psychoanalytic Journal. Mitscherlich is the editor. Secondly, through his clinical theoretical work in psychosomatics. It turns out psychosomatics is the main way that psychoanalysis gains strength within German medicine. Third, his activism, together with Adorno and Horkheimer, in bringing emigrated psychoanalytic celebrities back to address the West German public. Jürgen Habermas, of all people, just wrote a gush piece, which is going to come out in England. It's come out in English already in a Jewish journal, but it'll be out in German, like, in January, talking about how this project of bringing the psychoanalytic celebrities back in the 56 was one of the sort of life-changing experiences for him. And fourth, his directors, this is Mittelschloss is where it was originally, and that's Alexander Mitscherlich holding court in the Sigmund Freud Institute in Frankfurt in Mind that he directed. So on the one hand, he's Mr. Psychoanalysis. On the other hand, he also served as, quote, the conscience of the nation, a gentle repentance preacher. Mitscherlich managed to finesse this double role, not least by amalgamating creatively elements of Heinz Hartmann-esque American ego psychology. For you insiders, Hartman was probably the dominant figure in the United States. The 50s in America in psychoanalytic circles are referred to as the Hartman era. So he mixed this ego psychology that he imported from America with frankly left liberal political commentary on current events. He was openly political in a way that Hartman never was. With what in hindsight might appear to be completely unanalytic and conceptually clunky and joiners to West Germans to develop what he variously referred to as ego strength, Ich-Stärke, self-control, capacity for critical thinking, or the critical thinking capacity of the ego. He's obsessed with these phrases, and uses them all the time. The contrast with someone like his French counterpart, Jacques Lacan, whose baseline assumption is that there can be no such thing as a stable ego, could not have been starker. But for West German conditions, Mitscherlich's approach proved ideal. This was, after all, a culture in which contempt for psychoanalysis in the wider public and among medical professionals had been intensively fostered under the Nazis. So this, too, is a crucial part of the backstory. In the Third Reich, Freud was said to have, quote, a dirty fantasy and an Asiatic worldview. And psychoanalysis was deemed those to contain nothing original. This is all a quote. You can see my fingers doing this, right? For to claim otherwise would be to give too much honor to the unproductivity of the Jewish race and to be, quote, nothing other than the Jewish nation's rape of Western culture. I'm showing you a cartoon from 1933. This is typical. The old Jews in medicine, and then there's a cartoon on the side of a woman who comes in the doctor's office to say that she has a headache, and he asks her to free associate the way psychoanalysts do, and at some point she says, Deutsch, a knife. He goes, see, it's because you're sexually unsatisfied in your marriage. That's why you have a headache. I know how to cure you. So these attitudes, right? Psychoanalysis is Jewish, it's dirty, it's stupid and wrong, it's sex obsessed, and so on, hardly disappeared overnight in the war's aftermath. And despite this, Mitscherlich eventually succeeded spectacularly in convincing West Germans to think about psychoanalysis differently. Mitscherlich's work, here the stories are coming together, was profoundly shaped by an irritated, albeit sporadic, engagement with the astonishing public success of the animal expert Conrad Lawrence. This is just a random Google image of his head, as you can see, but there's a lot. In correspondence with mentors and friends, Mitscherlich declared his disdain for Lawrence and his sense of intellectual superiority to him. And already in 1964, 1 year after the book appears in German, Mitscherlich organized a workshop to which he invited Lawrence, and Lawrence came, whose express aim was to repudiate Lawrence's conclusions about aggression. The book resulting from this workshop eventually appeared pretty late in 1969 as Up to Here and No Further, Can Human Aggression Not Be Pacified? But actually, his relationship to Lawrence's oeuvre was more complicated. It is not just that already in his own earliest published writings on aggression, there was a two-part meditation in Psyche already in 56 and 58, Mitscherlich actually cites Lawrence favorably. In addition, in the magnum opus of 67, co-written with Margarete, The Inability to Mourn, it actually contains 8 essays, only the first of which is the title story, and the remainder of which return repeatedly to aggression. That book needs also to be read not only as a repudiation, but also as a partial incorporation of Lawrence's theses. So too, Mitscherlich's marvelous speech in 1969 on the occasion of his winning of the Peace Prize of the Frankfurt Book Trade, and it's great. If you read one thing by Mitscherlich, you should read this, On Hostility and Man-Made Stupidity. It's very relevant to the present as well. Remained in conversation with Lawrence's theses and was indisputably understood that way by the mainstream media. So when the Spiegel, which is the feminist liberal news magazine, in a reprint of the full text, plucked from the speech and shows in its headline the Mitscherlich remark that, quote, aggression is a fundamental force of life, clearly positioning the speech within the ongoing national fracas over how to feel about the existence and value of an aggressive threat. Aggression became one of the central themes of Mitscherlich's public life. In addition to The Inability to Mourn and Up to Here and No Further, he published or co-published 3 further books on the topic. Aggression and Adaptation in Industrial Society, which was co-written with Herbert Marcuse and others, The Idea of Peace and Human Aggressivity in 69, and Tolerance, Verification of Concept in 74, which contained multiple essays on aggression, cruelty, and war, including a reprint of the Peace Prize speech. The timing was crucial. Mitscherlich was just barely succeeding in getting psychoanalysis to be taken seriously in West Germany when Lawrence's so-called evil burst on the scene. A new spate of violence and wars around the globe in the 60s and after added a cacophonous diversity of possible resonances to what the Mitscherlichs had in The Inability to Mourn summarized succinctly as, quote, the aggression problems of our time. So they're gesturing to a whole raft of things. The US's escalation of the war in Vietnam from 1965 on, the renewed outbreak of war in the Middle East in 1967, eventually also the rise of violent leftist movements within the West, whose actions were in turn met by state violence. All of these provided occasions both to evade and to engage the actual intricacies of what had happened during the Third Reich. But in the West German context, Nazism and the Holocaust lurked behind nearly all the ensuing arguments. In other words, current events, whether it's Vietnam or the Middle East, complexly refracted the attempts to make sense of the national past. Nonetheless, it bears pointing out that the debates also went international. Among other things, the International Psychoanalytic Meeting in Vienna in 71 focused the entirety of its discussions around the question of an aggressive drive, with media from the New York Times to the Kansas Times covering the story. There's the Kansas City Times. Yeah. And of course, it's all going in. Okay, part three. The New Left. Although the New Left student movement that reshaped the political landscape of West Germany after the mid-1960s liked to describe itself as anti-fascist, it is better understood as an anti-post-fascist movement, by which I mean a movement developed in opposition to the more conservative earlier post-fascist settlement in West Germany. Certainly, there was something distinctively anti-post-fascist about the fury with which members of the West German New Left would attack Lorenz from the later 60s on. In the process, and this was something of a surprise, Lorenz and Mitchell were intermittently lumped together. Even though they disliked each other, they were treated by the young leftists as similar. And this is complicated because actually, in looking for father figures they could cope with, they actually liked Alexander Mitchell a lot. So the fact that he was disappointing them around this is striking. In the pages of the Venerable Weekly Die Zeit, one anti-Lorenz reviewer, a new leftist, opined in 1969, quote, "One really has to call it tragic. Mitscherlich is the sole German psychoanalyst who's determined to pursue the sociopolitical responsibility of the discipline with full earnestness and whose voice carries weight with the public. But he hardly ever gets concrete. Mitscherlich's thinking," this is still a quote, "is paralyzed by the unresolved contradictions of Freud's drive dualism," in other words, his idea that it's libido and aggression both. "In the final analysis, then, according to Mitscherlich, the decisive evils are, after all, only secondarily caused by society, because evil, hate, and pleasure and destruction are ineradicably biologically anchored in human nature," end of quote. So this is what the young leftists hated. They hated the idea that aggression is biological, that it's inborn, that it's inevitable. They were determined to emphasize that society encourages violence and that human beings could be changed if society were changed. Other new left critics of Lorenz were yet harsher. The editor of an anthology entitled So etwas zum Verdammt, Condemned to Aggression, in 71, blasted both Lorenz and Mitscherlich by name, but pointedly urged, quote, "above all the psychoanalysts," that's obviously a slap at Mitscherlich, "to spend the next decades on research and otherwise remain silent." The escalation of the conflicts over the value and causes of aggression, however, had another effect as well, because they inadvertently triggered a sarcastic backlash in the mainstream media against what rapidly came to seem like the New Left's severe naivete about the dark sides of human nature. This second round of nationwide debate about the source and function of aggression drew in many further passionately eloquent commentators. So in and around the generation of Lorenz, who was born 1903, like he's as old as the century, right? And Mitscherlich, born 1908, there was also the Freudian Marxist Frankfurt School philosopher and beloved mentor to the New Left, Herbert Marcuse, the German-British psychoanalyst Paula Hyman, the neo-Freudian social psychologist Erich Fromm, born 1900, the emigre philosopher Hannah Arendt, you've heard these names, these are important people, they're all weighing in on this, and the Viennese Los Angelian analyst and specialist on terrorism and hostages, Friedrich Hecker. Then there's an intermediate generation that I think is really interesting, born sort of 28 to 33, at the tail end of Weimar, right? And there were the philosophers Arno Pluck and Rolf Denker, the historian Hermann Glaser, and the poet and journalist Hans Krieger. And then in the younger generation, there was Mitscherlich's assistant at the Sigmund Freud Institute, the social psychologist Klaus Horn, who died young, who was incredibly interesting, just one of the most brilliant thinkers at that time, as well as the psychologist Herbert Zelk, education specialist Hans-Dietrich Dunn, the sociologist Wolf Lepenies, many of you know him. In 2006, he won the Peace Prize, and Helmut Nolte, and the political artist Hans-Georg Rock, right? So there are many, many prominent people weighing in on this issue. and the debate exploded all over the West German media. It also drew in new advocates for Lorenz, including Lorenz's student, the ethologist anthropologist. So this is Herbert Zelt criticizing Tully. You see, the violence is a product of education. This is an attack on Mitchell. And here we go. You can see what I mean about somebody who's sort of at the borders between studying animals and treating human beings, in this case, as an anthropologist. His name is Irenaeus Eibel-Eibelsfeld. He asserted early on in passing in his book, Love and Hate, in 1970, that both ethology, study of animals, and psychoanalysis, quote, have established that man has an innate aggressive drive. He took side swipes at Lorenz's left-wing critics, and he especially mocked the new left's sex radical communal experiments. In subsequent writings, Eibel-Eibelsfeld took aim at what he saw as the gullibility of the new left's, quote, educational optimism. I mean, he did this idea that you can have the bigger to raise your own kids not to be aggressive. He expressed doubt that, quote, one can prevent the development of undesirable tendencies simply through appropriate child rearing and somehow thereby dedicate a society without second order and without aggression. So if you get the general picture, the whole fight is about human nature. Is it naturally aggressive or not? And is that a good thing or not? And the thing you have to wonder about, why is this debate so intense? How come people get so worked up about theories? Only words control. Strikingly, some of Lorenz's critics fussed a great deal over whether or not Freud himself had really been committed to the notion of a death drive, or an aggressive drive, to keep on mixing up, because Freud was dead. So there was suddenly an outpouring of exegesis. People started reading Freud closely. But many who were unsettled or disgusted by Lorenz actively sought substitute models to explain human behavior, and were adamant that there could be no such thing as a non-libidinal drive, like the only drive is libido and everything else is society's problems. Or they emphasized that aggression was about all learned behavior, not innate, and that there was much that could be done to discourage its spread. This is a historian, Herman Glaser. It's an extremely interesting book. Among the most passionate critics of Lorenz were those who strove to combine a recovery of the work of the Freudian Marxist, Wilhelm Reich, who had famously contended in the 1930s in numerous variations that aggression was the result of the lack of sexual satisfaction, with an updated version of the, quote, frustration-aggression hypotheses of inter- and intergroup violence and scapegoating developed by psychologist John Dollard, that's him on the right, and his team at Yale, which had grown out of Dollard's fieldwork on black-white race relations in the U.S. South. And I highly recommend this casting class in the Southern Town, 37th, an amazing book. The philosopher Arno Fleck, for example, was outraged by what he diagnosed as Lorenz's feat in making non-sex but aggression the ordrung, the drive of all drives that moves everything that is living. This book, Die Gesellschaft und das Böse, Society and Evil, A Critique of the Reigning Morality, 67, was meant, as made clear by the hot pink cover and the booze, 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 evil, 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 all right, was meant as a definitive rebuttal to Lorenz. You can see the quote from him there. For Fleck, the enthusiasm for Lorenz and the public skepticism about the new left's efforts at sexual liberation and anti-authoritarian child-rearing were all part of one big package of misconceived morality. It was the dominant hypocritical morality in Fleck's view that had repressed and perverted the sexual drive and made pleasure and brutality and killing pervasive. As Fleck reductively but fervently declared, it would be wrong to hold the view that all of what happened in Auschwitz was typically German, was typical for a society that suppresses sexuality. So that's an extreme position, but there were actually many people who promoted it at the time. Another variation involved the reflections of Herbert Marcuse. He remained an unapologetic advocate, as he had been since the 1950s, for a radical and utopian understanding of the Freudian inheritance. However, simultaneously, his main preoccupation is a puzzle that has long preoccupied many members of the Frankfurt School. It has to do, also Eric Fromm, with whom he was labor at war, how the increasing powerlessness experienced by individuals in a competitive technological society exacerbated aggression and diminished individuals' capacity for critical political resistance. Mitscherlich's younger associate, Klaus Horn, also repeatedly built on Marcuse, Mitscherlich, and Freud in order to push beyond the stalemated terms of debate. Horn persistently challenged the Lorenzian's instrumental concept of the biological. He constantly referred to them as having an ontologized or reified approach, and so the biological is not completely separable from the social. He regarded it as no coincidence that in the U.S. as well, under the impact of the Nixon Restoration, he's writing this in 73, 74, there was an increasing backlash against Cold War liberal social engineering projects, a backlash based upon the pretext that there was, as an article in Fortune magazine had put it, and then it was from Saturday Review, right, human beings are not very easy to change, social engineers are given a fire. That Alexander article basically speaks about a basic intractability of human nature. In other words, it's hopeless, you can't change things, people will just serve, can't make them better. Horne had given a lot of thought to just how extraordinarily tractable, i.e. changeable, human nature proven to be under Nazism, and he found this whole argumentative appeal to an unchangeable human nature repellent. The whole point of sophisticated psychoanalysis, Horne contended, was to understand not just the continual interaction of biological and social, but literally their mutual constitutiveness. Part four. Nonetheless, despite these radical readings, already by the early 70s, a new version of Freud gained ascendancy in the Western media and among the wider public, finally securing his status as August authority. It did so, however, by portraying Freud as a conservative and a pessimist. So backing up for a second, as late as 1968, this is in the Spiegel, the inventor of psychoanalysis had been celebrated in Der Spiegel as one of the great liberators of humankind from centuries of hypocrisy around hostility to sexuality. And here Freud is placed rather startlingly in a lineage with the actively anti-sexual, certainly pro-sexual, Alfred Kinsey and William Masters. By 1971, however, the very same periodical with the very same photograph was explaining that Freud was increasingly being understood to lend gravitas to the downbeat idea that human nature irretrievably tended towards mutual unkindness. So it's Freud as a question researcher suddenly instead of Freud as a sex researcher, right? Quote, Freud's teaching about aggression and behavior research of Lawrence are ever more frequently being enlisted for the development of a conservative theory of society, end quote. Again in 72, a year later, Der Spiegel published an interview with the psychoanalyst Friedrich Hacker, focused upon his tone of aggression, that addressed him as, quote, a Freudian, and in the same breath invoked, as part of the interview question, Freud's view, delivered in the wake of the First World War, that a potential for aggression resides in the human being that has to find expression one way or another. While Hacker likes to speak to himself as more balanced, Der Spiegel placed his volume, along with a new one by Robert Arkley, among the, quote, recently constantly swelling ranks of books in which the conservative conception of a hierarchically organized society is being defended against the new left. It's a pretty good summary of what was going on. Now, perhaps it's not surprising that Hacker was placed there because his volume was graced with a foreword by none other than Conrad Lawrence. They had met in Topeka, Kansas, actually. Here and elsewhere, Lawrence was blatant in his disdain for the young rebels. He hated the hippies, and the hippies hated him. To 21st century eyes, our eyes today, the idea of accepting the existence of a drive for aggression in human beings might seem uncontroversial and banal, if sadly obvious, like yes, and so. Or it could seem, you know, wrong as a theoretical position, like maybe drive is not even the right way to think about it, but inconsequential and so. The pivotal point here is that under the very specific circumstances of a culture only 25 years away from what had been at the time a wealthy, popular, mass murderous dictatorship, the claim seemed to many people not just wrong, but emphatically and menacingly so. Even if not all commentators critical of Lawrence about the Holocaust, but rather pointed to current events unfolding in the present. So quite a lot of the commentary actually ends up being about the idea that Lawrence is offering excuses that legitimate the Vietnam War or other wars, as though it's hopeless to protest because human beings are just going to fight each other. And then, however, there was even more to it. Many of Lawrence's critics on the left were convinced that his entire purpose was to provide exoneration for the elder generation of Germans. A group around the young psychologist Herbert Zelt, I showed even before, explained, as Der Spiegel summarized it, the great public resonance of Lawrence's book in West Germany, by the way, it, quote, seems to exculpate all those whose slate did not stay completely clean, in accordance with the motto, if we have an aggressive drive, and this drive must be expressed, then we actually can't help ourselves that, when the ellipsis was in the original. It was an obvious gesture back to the past of the Third Reich. Already in 66, the philosopher Wolf Denker had bluntly proposed as a reason for Lawrence's bestseller status, quote, "No doubt, for one thing, the ongoing discussion of the gruesome deeds of the Third Reich. One looks for an answer to the question how something like that was possible." However, it's still Denker speaking, the way the book has been discussed until now would not galvanize people to actions against aggression or for its more sensible channeling, but rather is more likely to lead to disposing of the topic in a trivializing and affirmative way. For many, the expositions will have a reassuring effect. Who knows how many aging, publicly unknown fascists who received this book as a Christmas present have acquired a relieved conscience from reading it. Along related lines, summing the tone of the debates retrospectively in 1978, this was an example of Spiegel sort of educating people about how human nature is conservative for the here we have Klaus Tabelet. The magnum opus on proto-fascist and fascist patterns in German history, Tabelet too meditated on, quote, "the immense popularity of theories of human beings as intrinsically aggressive." And he deliberately associated those theories with Nazism, and especially with the self-exculpatory maneuvers of the high-ranking Nazi Hermann Göring, who from his Nuremberg prison cell in 46 had fascistly and self-servingly informed the American psychologist Jean Gilbert that, quote, "there's a curse on humanity. It is dominated by the hunger for power and the pleasure of aggression." So clearly, Tabelet thinks this is just self-exculpatory. The analyst Paula Hyman had been more careful and made no presumptions about Lawrence's motivations. But she was at pains to emphasize the profound non-comparability of Lawrence's feelings, Lawrence's findings about animals, in which interspecies aggression could serve the preservation of a species. This is her quote, "for which the preconditions are possession of territory, food, mating, group behavior, and which is limited in its ferocity by innate inhibitory mechanisms," end quote, "and the kind of brutalities that were unique to humans." What distinguished the human from the animal was twofold in Hyman's view. On the one hand, quote, "the feeling of pleasure that is derived from the tormenting and destruction per se," and on the other, "the human being's tendency to rationalize that pleasure and cruelty and to invent noble goals with whose help he disguises and implements his delight in destruction." As she pointedly added, and this was obviously again a gesture to the Third Reich, quote, "our memory of the human concept of Lebensraum is still fresh, and with it the sluices to unlimited and calculated cruelty were opened wide." Final part. One of Mitscherlich's most characteristic moves, this is classic for him no matter what the topic is, was to declare the insolubility of the theoretical questions. Already in The Inability to Mourn, the Mitscherlichs announced that, quote, "we do not know for certain whether there is such a thing as primary destructivity, or a genuine death drive, or whether the natural pleasure of aggression is transformed into the pleasure of inflicting pain only by experiences of impotence, humiliation, and loss of self-esteem." In other words, they have it all. Similarly, in 1969, in The Idea of Peace, Mitscherlich included a footnote repeating a point that he'd already made in his earliest Suka essays, which summarily remarked that, quote, "the difficult drive theoretical question about a primary drive pair, Eros Destrudo, or a reactive origin of aggressivity can hardly be answered on the basis of our current knowledge." And he keeps including this footnote everywhere he goes. Nonetheless, Mitscherlich undermined this agnostic stance, which is his favorite stance at other points, frankly expressing his commitment to Freud's concept of a death drive, acting dismissively towards what he interchangeably referred to as the behaviorist counter theory or the frustration theory, that's a gesture towards Stoller, right? Voicing objection to the doctrine that, quote, "man's hostility is simply a reaction to the disappointments which society has meted out to him," and distancing himself explicitly from the idea he described to Wilhelm Reich, in other words, that aggression and destruction derive from inhibited sexual urges. At other moments, however, Alexander Margaret Mitscherlich also freely incorporated ideas that sounded a whole lot as though they came from Wilhelm Reich. For example, in The Inability to Mourn, they noted that, quote, "the conclusion can hardly be avoided that aggression has to make up for missing an unattainable libidinal satisfaction." And later in the book, meditating on how the phenomena of, quote, "brutal excesses, such as torture, contain an element of perverted libidinal gratification," they remark that, quote, "the fact that throughout long periods of Christian history, sexual lust was banned, forced the individual to repress sexuality and to find partial substitute satisfaction in acts of destruction." I can give you more and more examples. I think I should stop, but in yet another essay from 1970, this one on sexual enlightenment for grown-ups. Mitchell is in his inevitably awkward but moving phrasing channeled a combination of Marcuse and Hartman when he reminded readers that Eros can only do its needed work in generating compassion in countless interpersonal as well as global political matters if it is permitted access to the ego through its shaping and conscious insight. Ultimately, Mitchell found the language he was looking for. In 1974, in an essay entitled Two Kinds of Cruelty, Mitchell, perhaps taking his cue from Paula Hyman, who had been his own training analyst, expressed what had been missing, and tellingly so, from the animal researchers and their obsession with proving the evolutionary origins of human aggression. The human animal differed from the others because it was not just aggressive, but cruel, holding fast to his conviction that, quote, the only psychological theory that keeps in focus the time-transcending phenomenon of cruelty is Freud's death drive. He's constantly saying, I'm loyal to Freud. Mitchell offered his most thoughtful comments yet on cruelty as pleasure versus cruelty as work. Both were uniquely human, but cruelty as work was the far more prevalent problem, and in his view, the strongest evidence that the death drive was real. Cruelty as work was, as he defined it, cruelty that was, one, approved by a collectivity rather than arising from a private predilection, right? This is relevant for genocide studies. It was characterized by an absence of subsequent remorse. It almost always depended on the absolute helplessness of the victims, and fourth, it was asexually destructive. As Mitchell put it, cruelty as work knows no orgasm. Instead, it is about piece rate labor, about managing one's daily allotment of tormenting and murdering. The destruction worker goes home in the evening like others do with the feeling of having had a busy day. Yes, this destruction worker might well experience pleasure, but it was in very few cases asexual pleasure. Instead, and here Mitchell borrowed both from the survivor of Gestapo torture, Jean-Henri, and from the narcissism theories of the Austrian-American analyst Heinz Kohut, it was an, quote, unhindered omnipotence experience, the realization of fantasies of a grandiose self, close quote. These were the dynamics Mitchell believed that had been most in evidence at Treblinka and Auschwitz, but also in the forest of Katyn, among the Brazilian death squads, at Kansan, that's the penal colony where the U.S. tortured communists, and at My Lai. The Marquis de Sade's elaborate fantasies have attracted at best a handful of followers throughout the centuries. Eichmann, by contrast, this is a quote, was of a different sort. He provided the killings the way one provides a supermarket with wares. It could be argued, looking back, that Lawrence's provocation pushed some rather productive theorizing into view. Mitchell at least found himself in a continual double argument, on the one side with the market competitor Lawrence, and on the other with the often overly simplistic but indisputably morally passionate New Left. All through the post-war decades, Mitchell had worked on multiple fronts at once, striving to shore up psychoanalysis' cultural authority, continually finding common ground between warring factions, and endlessly circling around knotty puzzles of human behavior while coaxing his fellow citizens to think along with him. So one could end the story here and just say that Mitchell was, in this way, a crucial contributor to a much larger worldwide post-45 reorientation of the psychoanalytic venture. But there is a coda to the story. Although rumors had circulated in professional circles in the 1960s that Lawrence had been a Nazi, the height of the debates about Lawrence's ideas about aggression, which was 63 to 73, occurred without any public mention of the possibility. Not until 1973, when it was announced that Lawrence would be winning the Nobel Prize. Jointly with his fellow Austrian Paul von Frisch and the Dutch-British Nicolaas ten Bergen for their, quote, discoveries concerning organization and elicitation of individual and social behavior patterns in animals, were journalists spurred to investigate and find Lawrence's initially vehemently denied Nazi party affiliation, as well as nasty eugenicist remarks he had put in print in 1940 about the degeneration purportedly caused by domestication of humans as well as of animals, and in which he had unabashedly called for a, quote, sharper eradication of the less ethically valuable. Lawrence subsequently declared his own phrasing unfortunate and claimed that his use of the word eradication had never meant murder, and he made semi-apologetic remarks in the autobiography produced for his Nobel acceptance in 1973. Scholars in the 1970s and into the present disagree about the significance of his Nazi sympathies, some seeing him as at worst a badly naive opportunist, while others are convinced not only of his malice, but of the corrupting influence of racist and eugenicist perspectives on the quality of his science. Further eugenicist writings produced between 38 and 43 were found later. Lawrence, however, here I want to show you this. This is an interview published at the occasion of his 85th birthday, when he became a major anti-atomic energy activist. Further eugenicist writings were produced, but he remained rather uninhibited in his views. At the occasion of this interview at his 85th birthday in 1988, for instance, he remarked in an interview about his annoyance that, quote, humanity has done nothing sensible about overpopulation. One could, for this reason, develop a certain sympathy for AIDS. One could develop a certain sympathy for AIDS. HIV, okay. And once again, he invoked the peculiar language he had used in 1940, explaining that, quote, ethical people have fewer children, but criminals were breeding uncontrollably. This is, my final paragraph, this is, without question, a weird story, one filled with unexpected, unplanned effects. But to conclude, the short version of my argument is that, despite the best efforts of Adorno and Horkheimer, and above all, Alexander Mitscherlich, through a complex set of circumstances, it was, irony of ironies, ultimately an ex-Nazi who succeeded in bringing psychoanalysis back to post-Nazi Germany.